So my name is Olani Olakunle, which is a little bit difficult to pronounce. So you can call me Ola for sure. And I am a DBA in Bilpay, which is a Berlin e-commerce company. And I do some development too, but my talk basically here is based on how to move log tables from the production database to a different database, and to be able to use the same changes coming from the production database in different downstream applications. So that's basically my talk today.
You're welcome, everybody. And I hope you had fun time in the keynote speech, because I learned a lot of things. And I hope you are going to learn a few things from this talk as well. So my topic today is a new way to avoid trigger-based logging in Postgres. And it shouldn't be misunderstood that we need to get rid of triggers altogether, because if you think about it, we cannot. And they are essentially there for a reason, and very important reason as well. So a little bit about me. I am from Berlin. I'm a database administrator with Bilpay, BMBR, and the other guys are smiling because, yeah, they know. And we just got acquired by a Swedish company called Planum. So we are part of the Planum group of companies. So don't be mistaken when you see that I'm from Bilpay, but I have a Klarna email address. So it's all the same company. So database logging, and basically in this talk I'll be kind of giving you a use case from our company point of view. So I figured that it's going to be a lot easier to pass the message across, telling you what we've done, how we use all of these technologies. So as far as best practices go, we basically log events in tables using triggers. So we log inserts, we log deletes, we log updates. I mean, we all know how that works. And sometimes, or even most times, the destination tables do not have the same structures as the originating tables. So that also means that you have to do some fine-tuning, you have to write some functions that do some data manipulation. And usually for us, when it comes to auditing, we are interested in who did what, when do they do what, what actually did they do. And all of these requirements sometimes means we have to write some really complicated functions for our triggers. And you can already see how this is going to go, because it's going to increase your commit time for your transactions. So with that in mind, let's look at some considerations. We basically use triggers because they're essentially easy. I could write a function and put it in a trigger in a few minutes, and it's up and running. And they're incredibly easy to do. And the actions, of course, that you do in a trigger tells the amount of overhead you incur in any activity you do. And of course, you can also begin to imagine that there will be some limitations as to some things you can really not do in a trigger functions. And we still have some more considerations. And for us, sometimes it's important that we separate the logging tables or the audit tables from the production database. So that would mean that you have to write a cross-database trigger, which already you would start frowning at, like, no, you shouldn't do that. And we also want to be able to do more with the changes that come from the table. We want to be able to do, because they have changes, they are like logs, they are logs, of course, we want to be able to do a lot more things with it, not just logging tables or doing audits and all of that. We want to do more with it, and we want to exploit those changes for different downstream applications. And you should begin to ask, where does this lead us? As you would have guessed, takes us back to logical decoding. That's something that got introduced in Postgres in 9.4. And how do we do this exactly? Or before we get to how we do it exactly, let's see a little bit of what logical decoding is. So number one is it extracts all persistent changes to a database table. So the keyword is persistent and A, which means that until it is committed, you cannot decode it. And the slots are actually attached per database, not for an entire cluster. And changes you can get in a commit in the commit order. So you can replay everything that essentially happens in your database in the order they were committed. And then the outputs are also provided in an easy to understand format. You don't need a knowledge of the internals of the database to be able to use it, although some of the knowledge will come in handy when you face some problems, but essentially it's not a basic requirement. And you extract the contents of all files into application-specific format, depending on what output plugin and what application you're using. And if you are anywhere below Postgres 9.4, it probably will not really work for you because logical coding got introduced in Postgres 9.4. So what do you need to make this happen? First, you need to change some configuration in your Postgres SQL conf file. You need the maximum while senders to be increased. You need to increase the number of replication slots to greater than zero, of course, and you also need the while label to be set to logical. And in your PG8VA config, you need to allow replication connection, depending on the interface you're using, of course. And you need an output plugin written in C, and you need a suitable client to be able to consume those changes. So if you have all of these, you are good to go. And let's see, what are the components of logical coding? They are basically replication slots. You need to be able to create a replication slot in your database. And this is what gives you the mechanism to be able to store the changes in the tables such that they can be replayed in the order with which they are committed back to a client. And you need an output plugin, of course. And that output plugin is what essentially goes to your wall files and be able to extract those changes and be able to play it back to a consumer that is reading from it. And you need a consumer client to be able to do that. And you could basically write up any client that you can either use the SQL interface or the streaming replication interface. And with that said, we have two kinds of replication slots. The physical replication slots and the logical replication slot. Physical replication slot we're already using in for streaming replications with the replicas. You don't need to do anything. You just need to create it and your replica uses it, so you don't need an output plugin. And it consumes everything. So all the changes, the DDL, the insert, everything gets moved, shipped from the master database to the replica database. That's easy enough. But when it comes to logical replication slots, you basically need an output plugin. This is used for logical decoding, which means we can have a table level extraction of the changes in the database. And DDLs are not decoded, at least until this moment. It doesn't support DDL extractions. So let's take a look at the output plugins. And number one, it must be written in C, so you can basically interface with Postgres to be able to utilize some various callbacks, and must be installed on the database for which you want to create your application slot. And for us, kind of introduce to you or talk about the different output plugins we've tried and the outcome of all of this. So the first thing, of course, is to try the test decoding, which is essentially not very useful except for the fact that it gives you a very good basis to see what the replication slot or the changes is spitting out, and to be able to serve as a basis for you to develop your own output plugin. Other than that, it's really not useful in production. But it has some very good output format. You can already see it there. You see how when the transaction begins, you see when it's committed, you see all the changes in between. And you can already begin to see that if you have to pass all of the record in this, it's going to require some drawing of air and some heating of air on the table to be able to get all of this in the right format. And with that, it's basically not very useful in production. So we got a feel of how the changes will be played, but that's where it ended. You can't use it anywhere else. And then we went to PG Logical Output, which is a very great output plugin developed by the guys from Second Quadrant, and was really fast, was extremely fast. Of course, it also has a JSON output format, which is a very good thing, which means you can easily pass all of the objects in it. And it's a widely accepted format, so it was really easy for us. But they stopped supporting a standalone PG, the output. The PG Logical output as a standalone doesn't exist anymore. It existed. It still exists, actually, but it's not being currently developed. It's being merged into the PG Logical project. So it becomes really easy to be able to use something like that in production, that you don't have bug fixes, you don't have new releases and all of that. So even though it's really fast and good and easy to use, it's not much of an option to continue using it because the guys that are developing it is not really actively supporting the standalone version. So we turn to World to JSON. And it's still alive, it's currently alive, still being developed, still have a lot of bug fixes, a lot of releases and all of that. And it still has, and it does have a JSON output format, a funny looking JSON output format, but it does have a JSON output format, and provides an acceptable decoding speed, which is an important factor in this case. And they also have some very exciting or enticing features, which you can include or exclude schemas you're not interested in. You can also get from it the transaction timestamp, the LSN, and it also gives with it, because with it, the data types. So if you are moving to a different database, for example, you're extracting the change from Postgres and trying to save it in a different database, you can do the data type transformation. So that, we find that really useful. And it also supports a lot of environments, even Windows. So this is how the output format looks like. And all of this, if you have an option to be able to replay all of them in a single JSON file, but that would quickly result in a problem if you have a very huge transaction. That means that the memory requirement will be spiked, the lag will be a lot, and all of that problem just comes in your production environment. So in most cases, you want to play the changes one after the other. And if you see, these are essentially three lines. So you get the first line, which looks like change with a open square bracket that essentially does nothing. So you need to be able to tell your client to look for that and know that, okay, when you see this, this is the beginning of a transaction. And if you see the closing, call the bracket, is the end of the transaction. And everything in between is the change. And but we learned to get by with that and to be able to transform it into a different format that I will show in later part of this slide. So how much data is good enough when it comes to logical decoding? And that essentially brings us to the replication identity, the replica identity. So for each of the table you are trying to decode, you can set the replica identity for them. The default is that when you create a table, it gets with it a default replica identity, and that essentially means that it only gets the new records, and if the primary key or a column that belongs to the primary key gets changed, you can also get the new and the old record for those, nothing else. And you can also use a unique index to be able to get the changes, and this also gives you the same as what a default replica identity does. Just in this case, it's not using a primary key, it's using a unique index, which are essentially the same. And you can set it to full, you can set the replica identity to full, which means that in this case, your table doesn't necessarily need to have a primary key or a unique index. In this case, you get all the changes, the new and the old of all the columns all of the time. And of course, that will always almost immediately tell you that the login is going to be a lot. But the amount of data you're going to be fetching from it is going to be a lot. And depending on your transaction and production, might be something you want to consider. And there is another one that's also interesting. It does nothing, but it's also very useful. It's a replica identity, nothing. So if you want to basically turn off the changes from a particular setup table, you can just set the replica identity to nothing, and you don't fetch anything from it. So what are the clients that we use? Our client of choice was Python. Basically, thanks to these Zalando guys, they did a fix on the CyclePigeon that included logical decoding. So he was shocked. He wasn't quite sure what I was saying. Yeah, but they did a fix on the CyclePigeon, which also included logical decoding. And that was quite easy to use and very performant as well, and worked pretty well for us. And if you're interested, there are also other clients you could use. There's the JDBC driver that works pretty well. And there's, of course, the LPQ from C, which is basically all you need. And for the Python, you set your connection factory. And if you're dealing with byte arrays, you probably don't want to set your decoding to true for the logical decoding, because then when it comes back to you and you move it to wherever it's going, it essentially becomes gibberish. So you probably want to keep that in mind. And for an oversimplified architecture, this is basically what it looks like. So what we do is we create a bunch of replication slots on our production databases, and we have clients that fetches it and moves it to Kafka. I mean, for testing, you could do from the database directly to wherever it is that you're going, but if the downstream application is out and it's not consuming the WAL, you might essentially run into a problem because it keeps storing the WAL files until they are consumed before it recycles them. So if your downstream application is down for a considerable amount of time, that means that it keeps accumulating the WAL files, and you might run into space issues. And this doesn't look like really feasible, but it does happen. I've seen databases go down into panic mode once or twice because the location for the WAL files is full. So it's something that it's really worth considering. So in that case, since you don't have a 100% guarantee that your downstream application will be up all of the time, or maybe you don't even control the downstream application, so this are situations that probably are out of your hand. So what you can control is that you always make sure that your replication slots are being consumed, which means that for us, we turned into Kafka. So we just move everything from the replication slots and we queue them in Kafka. So whoever wants to use that stream connects to the topic in Kafka and uses them. So in that case, you are 100% sure that your production database gets their slot being consumed, and you control that part of the architecture, and every other thing the other people can take care of. So that's basically for us how it looks like. So anything there, it's like a bunch of things that it's going to be very confusing when I show them here. So essentially, let's get back to login intervals. So how do we do that in practice? First, we create a logical replication slot using the WaltJSON plugin output. And as an example, we create a table, put it all in a transaction, we do an insert, we do an update, and we commit it. So how do we actually queue in reality? This is how we queue in reality in our Kafka topic. And you can see that this is a match between the output format of the PGLogical output and the WaltJSON output. So we picked the best of both worlds. So we have the commit time embedded in it. We have the start LSM. So if you're interested in that, you can pick it. You see the action that is there. You see the transaction ID. And you can also see the changes that happen there. So the empty one is the create table. statement because it does not ship DDL. You see that is an empty transaction. So that in itself, we will give the consumer an idea that there is a DDL chain here. So if you, depending on your use case, if you have a catch DDL in your application that's doing stuff with it, so you know that you have to validate that catch and refresh it because there's a DDL chain. And in the other ones, you can see there's the relation, there's the new tuple. But you'll also notice here that you only have new tuples, even though we did an update. And that's to tell you that the default for a new table, it has a replica identity that's default, so it doesn't pick the old records for update. And how do we change this? So all we need to do is to set the replica identity to full. If we want the old and the new records. So of course, it also depends on your use case. If your use case only requires you to have the new records or the new tuples, you don't need to bother about it. But if your use case requires you to have both the new and the old record, then you probably want to set the identical and replica identity, identity to full for selected tables or all of the tables if you want. And what will this look like when we're done with that? You see that now we did an update and we have both the new record and the old records. So you can essentially pick this and insert it or do whatever you want with it. In our case, for our login tables, we have the new record and we have the old record. So we have columns that shows the new record and we have columns that shows the old record. So for us, it's important that the tables we are logging has replica identity full because we can essentially pick everything that happened and everything that was before. So meanwhile, in database 2, for example, this is how it looks like. And this down is an oversimplification of what essentially happens, right? Because all you need to do is fetch the JSON file and get the rows out of it and do an insert. So depending on your consumer application, which you are completely free to decide whatever happens in there, you can. That's what determines what you do right there. But essentially, you can already see that you can pick the changes that happen in your database, and you can move it down to a different database using the consumer. And that would essentially work. So for us, we just move it from the production database, we take it to Kafka, and from Kafka, we replicate the consumers, and then goes back to the different database. So in cases where we have like really huge log tables that, I mean, for us, we have log tables that of different purposes. There are some we don't query. And of course, the first thing that will come to mind will be, why don't you just put them in a different table space and put them in a slower disk on the same database? But then it also increases the maintenance overhead. So for us, this is an easy case for us to move them into a separate hardware where we know that, I mean, these are log tables that are huge. They are important for historical reasons. And if we ever need to go back there, we can just go back there. And if the database is down for an hour or two, nobody really, really cares about that because we just know that this is an historical table. And we have to go back and replay it when it's back up. And there are also some log tables that are essentially useful for us that we want to query, but they're also huge and we want to be able to do other things with it. It's also a good use case for us to be able to move them into whatever places that we need. And there are also sometimes that we need data from a production database in a different database for some reasons. And this is also a good reason, or this is also a good way for us to be able to match those data in the different databases. So another use case, we also use this for our data warehousing, which means that essentially in the old days, what we used to do is have the data warehouse loading maybe every 3 hours or every 5 hours or sometimes in the night. So if you look at the Grafana chart, you see some spikes in some time of the night and it's dark down, that's you know that, okay, this is when the data warehousing is trying to load all the data. But we realize that logical decoding essentially makes this a lot easier for us. which means that all you need to do is a base, is to have a base data for the production database, and then you create a replication slot, and essentially you can play all the changes to the data warehouse as it happens. So that means the BI guys don't have to go back and load the to load the data every 1 or 2 hours or 3 hours. They are the consumer directly connected to Kafka and picking all the changes, and they can have it in almost real time, the new changes in their state database. So this is a lot of stress saving for them, and it gives them the data like as quickly as they can get it. And next, we also use it for aggregation. We have some queries maybe in the production database that looks at the history of the consumer or of an order until forever, until when the order is created and like that. And you want to do that for a lot of customers, it's going to take a lot of your processing power. So what do? Since we have all of the changes for that consumer or for that customer in any case, we can essentially just take them from Kafka, have a suitable consumer, aggregate all the data and put it in a separate database. And that in itself would save you a lot of processing power. So essentially we also do this, and of course does it in the same way like almost as we did, as we do in the data warehousing. And database major upgrades. So I put a question mark there because we are still actively developing this, and essentially you could use the same principle to do a database major upgrade, because you have all the changes from this database and you are replaying them to a separate database. So essentially what you can do is you have the master and the replica, promote the replica, take the replica out of the cluster, or do the upgrade of the replica, because of course for that you don't need the downtime for your application, because the application still connects to production and other replicas. You can do the upgrade and replay everything that happened in the master back to the replica, but in the upgraded format. And then you can now form replicas from that backwards. So essentially this gives you like close to a few milliseconds downtime if you have to do a major upgrade. And this is worry-free, because then you can essentially test and see that is this upgrade or is this upgrade working well before you actually go live with it. And yes, we face some problems for sure. And first, is if you have a slow output, you will see a considerable lag in the amount of how you replay the WAU or how you consume the WAU files. You see the lag, and if your downstream application depend on being as close as possible to the production environment, then it's almost not usable at that moment. So you want to be able to make sure that your output plugin is fast enough for you to get very close to the production. And when I say very close, most of the time we achieve like sometimes it's in milliseconds. It happens in the master, it's already in the destination database. And yes, sometimes you have huge transactions and you ask somebody, this transaction is too huge. You're like, no. I have it in a function that does a loop and it should be smaller transaction. But not knowing that you have essentially a function, it's a single transaction. It doesn't matter what you do in that loop. At the end of it, it commits everything. And then you have millions of rows that needs to be decoded. And within it, you have DDLs as well. And then everything just goes like to standstill, to trying to decode it. And when it gets back, you are like sometimes 30 minutes or 1 hour lag. So this, if you still have a downstream application that depends on that, that's probably something you also want to consider. And of course, you want to be able to, it makes sense if you can help it to have transactions that are as small as possible. So it makes everything a lot faster. And duplicate entries, you have to be able to adequately trace or to actually monitor your progress, otherwise, or have something in place to be able to deal with duplicate entries in Kafka. So in that case, you don't need to really worry about it. In the data warehouse, it doesn't really matter because we just do an offset. It's there, you just update it, and if it's updating the same record, you get the same record in any case. So in the data warehouse, it's idempotent. But when it comes to some kind of aggregation, depending on your algorithm, it's something you also want to consider. And of course, it's a new and exciting way to send your database into panic mode. If you do not consume your slots and your disk fills up, since your database just goes down, and you have to fix that before you can go ahead. So a little bit of monitoring. Basically, there's not much here. You can see the PG replication slots to see what slots you have in your database. You can see the start replication to see how much you have flushed, how much you have sent, and there's a bunch of functions in replication origin you can use to trace or to monitor the progress of your replication. And yes, for useful tweaks, we find that some tweaks are important when it comes to using this in production. And we set the absolute minimum replica identity for each table. So if we don't need the new and the old records for those tables, we just set it to default. And some of the tables we don't even need, we set it to nothing. And some of the tables that are important, we set it to full because we need the new and the old records for them. And we also try to maintain as little as possible the number of replication slots on each database. And that's also easy because we send them to Kafka in any case. So that means that if you send everything, all the changes from the database to Kafka, you can essentially have different downstream application using the same stream but from Kafka. So in any case, you only need just about one slot in a production database. And if you want to perform a DDO and you are strong as Chuck Norris and decide to add a column with a default value in a huge table in a single SQL statement, you probably don't want to do that. But essentially that happens when there is a release and somebody does that and it's too late to stop it in any case, because there's going to be an essential rewrite of that entire table to apply the default value for that column. So in any case, what you want to do is set the replica identity for that column, for that table to nothing, run your DDL, and set it back to the old value of your replica identity. And something else is don't try to use the SQL interface in production. That's going to some really bad things will happen. So, these are useful links. This would give you auto-JSON, PG logical output, and I'm also talking to the management to be able, so we can open source our clients, the producer and the consumer clients, so we can have it on GitHub, so everybody can use it or criticize it or do something with it. So, and with that, brings me to the end of my presentation. So if you have any question, please feel free.
I think was really clear, and thank you for the talk, Colin.